Danny O'Donoghue from The Script. It's been a long time, mate. It's great to see you. How are you doing?
I'm really good. Really good. It's a beautiful Friday morning. It's get ready for the weekend. I've already been training, so I'm feeling pretty good, yeah.
You know, Cool FM and The Script go a way, way back.
Yeah, we do.
But I didn't think it was long enough for you guys to be doing a greatest hits tour. Thinking back, I remember you guys coming to town. You were just starting out. You did a gig for us, and I think it was the Spring and Air Break. I think that was before it became Limelight 1 and Limelight 2. It was for a bank, if I remember rightly. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do. Yeah. You know what? It's kind of frightening because like when the thoughts of the label wanted us to do, they're always trying to get us to do a greatest hits. And we're kind of like, I just feel like it dates the band a little bit. But we've been out now. We're on our seventh number one album, and I kind of feel like we're a little bit more prolific than other bands. As in, like we'll tour for a year, record for a year, release a record, tour for a year, record for a year. And COVID for me was one that, you know, I didn't even know if we would get it back out again and tour. So for me, like it feels like the right time to do it. Like things are starting to feel like they're opening back up again, and they're starting to, you know, get things back together again. Like. And like I think the music industry as a whole is always suffering, you know, with our crew and everybody else that's been out of work for such a long time. So now feels like the right time to go back. But to answer your question, it feels crazy to be doing a greatest hits tour. But it was either that it was going to be called the greatest hits tour or the karaoke tour, because I just want to go to like a field or a bar and just sing my favorite songs with my favorite people, you know, and go and see my favorite bands and stuff like that. So that's kind of the reasoning behind what and why we're doing this greatest hits, you know. But I believe you too. I was like, I don't feel like I'm old enough to have a greatest hits. I don't even feel like we deserve it, if you know what I mean, in a way. So, but it's really honorable. It's very humbling, and I'm totally honored, you know.
There's been so many singles, so many amazing gigs. I remember speaking to you guys on our old dilapidated broadcast bus out the back of Oxygen many years ago.
Yeah, and we had, by the way, we had the same dilapidated, broke down bus, don't worry.
So listen, you're still writing away. What's the last couple of years been like for you in terms of fueling your creativity? Did you just down tools for a while, or did you find that it inspired you?
It definitely spurred me on to write new stuff. I think COVID was the first time that I've really had a chance to sit back. Well, it was almost like a forced rest, because I'm a workaholic, so I really enjoy getting out there and being in the mix and, you know, being competitive all the time. But this was the first time where the brakes were on for everybody. And I think you get to examine your life a little bit. You know, we've definitely been blessed with a great career. But again, what I've done to try and get that career, I've probably blocked out, you know, some, you know, relationships, and I've let people down and missed birthdays and I've done a lot of stuff that when I sit back and I look at it, I wasn't proud of. But, you know, for me, the 2 years that we were kind of chilling at home, I tried to mend those bridges and tried to, you know, sort out my own life. And so people would look from the outside and say, well, you have got a great career, you have everything. But, you know, behind every great career is a wake of, you know, sometimes destruction. And sometimes, you know, when you look back, you kind of think, wow, we really, really were just like rocketing up to the stars, you know what I mean? And whatever happened. And so, for me, I find it immensely creative periods to be able to sit back and reflect, because what a writer does is they purge, you know, they get it all out. And for me, you know, I spent this time working on just lyrics alone, because I'm like, well, how do I articulate such weird, strange feelings that also the entire world is going through at the one time? It's probably the first time we've ever, maybe since, you know, like a world war or something, where the whole entire world has felt something at the same time and is experiencing it at the same time in different languages, in different places in the world, in different temperatures, in different weather systems. So I feel empowered to write about it from my aspect of, you know, of wow, this what an amazing experience I've had, but now it's all just, what if it never happens again? You know, what if that was the best part of my life? And I think everybody was figuring that as well. What if the bit just before we were all in lockdown, what if that was the best it was ever going to get? And now it's always going to be like, I was watching the comedians, like everything seems to be like 10, 15% worse. I was going to say the word like just a little bit worse than it was before. And like the crowds are 10% smaller. The laughs, like the bars are 10% less full. The crack is 10% less, you know, all the way around. So, but I don't feel that way. I feel incredibly optimistic about the future, about the band. I still feel like I'm in my prime as far as a songwriter goes and a performer. So that's what I'm so excited to get back out and just pull people by the neck back into life again and back into, do you know what I mean? Like grab people by the collars and just be like, look, you know, we're back at it again. Cause I believe Irish people as a whole, we're such a social creature and such a social beast that this tour for me is just gonna, I feel like it's gonna set the touch paper alight for the next 10 years, you know? So yeah, can't wait.
Obviously you're coming to Belfast to perform and we're really looking forward to it, but just be prepared. The Belfast crowd will just sing the words to you the whole night.
Yeah. Well, you know, Belfast, the whole of Ireland for me is the best place you could ever perform. You know, we're so proud of people that come from the whole entire island, you know, whether it's north or south. And I feel like that I can't wait for the lights to go down, the crowd to start going crazy, and for us to get back out and remind ourselves what it was we used to do beforehand, before all this crazy nonsense, you know?
You know, we are so excited to give our listeners the opportunity to come and see you in Belfast. And over this month, if you hear two Script songs back to back and you get through to us, you get a pair of tickets for the Belfast show. But if you hear three Script songs in a row and you get through to us, we're going to send you to New York City to see you guys, which will be incredible. And you've had the opportunity to tour the world, but in terms of performing, where does New York sit? Is it right up there?
Yeah, it's, you know, it's the map pass. Like I said, Ireland is number one. You know, UK would come in a close second, but New York to us is so special because it's so far away. It's got a massive history with Irish people leaving the shores of Ireland and heading over. That was the first port, was New York. So, you know, the whole strip, New York, Philadelphia, Boston, is an amazing experience for us to go over there. But we've got, you know, how many Irish people and descendants that there are living in New York. And it seems like the script, whenever we play there, it seems to be like a St. Patrick's Day. It's like a big parade. Like people come dressed and they've got shamrocks on their faces and they've got like, it's a whole other experience. That's why we picked New York for the competition, because it's the Mecca. You know, if you made it in New York and you're playing a gig in New York, then fair play to you. Do you know what I mean? It seems like you're doing something right. So for us, Radio City Music Hall is a place where we've had the most magical nights there. And when we were doing this tour around, so we're playing some places, we're playing our favorite places to play, and other places are the giant arenas and stadiums and stuff like that. So this is one of our, it's a mid-sized gig, but it's one that we've played many a time before, and we've literally had our best memories in this place. So yeah, whoever wins these tickets, man, is going to be very lucky.
Your music has really stood the test of time. We love playing your songs on the radio, and this is a hard one and you may not be able to answer it, but out of all your songs, which one do you enjoy performing live the most?
I mean a lot of the songs, this is probably a blanket answer, it's like a politician, but a lot of the songs, they're part of my life, you know. We write our own songs from top to bottom, and I feel like, you know, there are other bands out there that perform songs that get written for them, and maybe that they don't have the same attachment to them. But, you know, we've got songs all the way across, from the very first song that really connected with the world, like The Man Who Can't Be Moved, because it deals with such a subject that it's not about buying your way back in or Lamborghinis or houses. It's just like doing something, doing a great task and sitting on the corner and waiting for somebody to come back and maybe... You know, it's just like, it's kind of like a Forrest Gump style character who goes back to the corner where he first met his girlfriend and he doesn't know what he's doing and why he's there. So that the connection of that song seems to really resonate no matter where you are in the world, you know, be it, you know, Asia, Europe, all the way to America. Hall of Fame is something that is like from being the heartbreak band to being, you know, let's punch the Scotty band, you know. Hall of Fame is another one that we nearly finish it every night since we wrote the song. It's the closer of the show, because it just gives you such a sense. Even today, like I'll listen to that song. I hear the song. A lot of ones I get a bit embarrassed about listening to. You know, if I'm in there training away, Hall of Fame comes on, I always just get amped. It's like I'm listening to Eye of the Tiger or something. But I'm like, I wrote it deadly, you know. But you know, the other songs like If You Could See Me Now, you know, that's about our parents and our the fact that our parents aren't there to watch us in these shows, and you never really realize when you're writing the song that I'll be on stage singing the song about lyrics about me standing on stage singing a song and my mum and dad not being there. So every night for me is very special because I live in the moment most of the time. I try and live in the moment most of the time. But songs like that remind me that the lyrics and the music that we write comes from somewhere. And there is history to the band. And there are people there that didn't even make it to see us making it. If you know what I'm saying, my father, he passed away before the script were a success. But I remind myself of that every day. And I remind myself how special it is for us to be in a band. I had a lifetime in music. But every one of those songs has a little lyric in it that just reminds me, or, you know, slaps me in the face, or wakes me up, or splashes water, or cold water, and there's a kind of wake-up call. So I do love them all. But Man Who Can't Be Moved would be very special. Hall of Fame. And If You Could See Me Now, I think those three, I really look forward to performing those every night.
Danny, you know what? It's been brilliant to chat again. Thanks so much for giving up your time. We're excited to see you in Belfast. And I'm sure our overall winner will love seeing you in New York. I'll say one thing before I go, mate. You're looking really well. You haven't aged a bit.
Thanks, dude. That's been off the road. You know what I mean? That's being off the road, not being in the bus. Oh, we got the visuals, the photographs of what the bus that we're going to be in America. And I'm like, it looks amazing. What's the height in it? You go, that's 6'2". I'm like, I'm 6'4". I was like, it's literally, it looks like MTV Cribs bus, except for it's 2 inches too small. So I'm going to be walking around the thing like this. That's when I look me worse when I come off tour. You know what I mean? I'm all like, all disheveled, all out of shape, you know? Hilarious. But listen, you guys have been champions and supported us for a long, long, long time, ever since back in the days when we hadn't got a bus. So I really appreciate all your help and all the listeners up there as well. We can't wait to come and perform and get that lucky winner. Keep listening to the show and then hear those three script songs in a row.